Happy good getting up morning. Aren't you glad he got up those many years ago? Me too. I am glad to see all of you here today. It's particularly good to see Miss Brenda Adcock be able to be with us today. We're glad that she and her caretakers have come. Also, I forgot to recognize her about 5 or 6 weeks ago, but Judy Yates has been back for 5 or 6 weeks, but I just forgot to announce it. Welcome to those of you who are online today as well. We pray that it'll be a time that is meaningful for all of us as we worship our Lord, who has indeed risen from the grave. Most of the announcements you're going to have to read for yourself because I just ran out of time this morning. Started at 5 o'clock and I still didn't have enough time. So, but I do want to say a special thanks to Derry and Jimmy and Stacy for cooking breakfast for us this morning, as well as Chan, who helped serve. And I appreciate all of y'all doing that for us. And all I can say, if you weren't there, it was your loss and my gain because I ate twice. The office, church office, will be closed tomorrow for Easter. And honestly, I don't know any other announcements. Read your bulletins, please, and you can find those out for you. We will be taking the Lord's Supper during the service today. I will go on and share with you the only requirement. It's not to be a member of this church, but to know Jesus Christ, your Savior, and to have received him as your Savior and Lord. And it's his table, not ours. So I would share that with you. This time we'll join together as we begin our service of worship with our instrumentalist, followed by Trey with our call to worship. Thank you. you're able, would you join us in standing for our call to worship and our prayer of invocation and our opening?
Good morning. I will be reading our call to worship, Why Have We Gathered Today? After nights of deep darkness,
we come in the light of this Easter morning.
We come in search of something.
We come in search of the living.
We come in search of the living one.
We come in search of the resurrected one.
We come with eyes open to encounter the risen Christ.
We come to hear Jesus Christ is not in the tomb.
Christ is not among the dead. He is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Amen.
Y'all may be seated. If you all will pray with me, please. Dear Father, come into our presence and bless us, dear Father, like you never have before. Dear God, we thank you and praise you so much for your son and his life. He died such a cruel death. However, the victory over death, as we celebrate his rising today. Lord, I pray that everything is said and done in this service is pleasing to you, and that it's for your honor. For these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Now if you'll stand again, we'll be like true Baptists, standing and sitting all the time. We'll sing We Welcome Glad Easter. Time for the children's message.
Situated. Good morning. How are y'all doing today?
Good.
Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
Are y'all having a good Easter today? Everybody's dressed in their nice Easter clothes and looking so pretty. Do you guys like surprises?
Yes.
Yeah? Everybody likes surprises, right? But sometimes there's bad surprises and good surprises. But we're going to have some good ones today. I'm going to let you guys look in these bags. And we're going to talk a little bit about some Easter symbols. You want to tell me what's in there? Eggs, Easter eggs. Y'all seen Easter eggs? Y'all hunted Easter eggs already? Do we talk about Easter eggs in the Bible, though?
No.
Does that mean we can't have fun with Easter eggs?
No.
Yeah, we can still have fun with Easter eggs, but we got to remember what's important. So, Jonah, reach in here and pull out what's in this bag. Oh, look. That's a cross. Now, this is an important Easter symbol, right?
Uh-huh.
Y'all know why? What? Kelsey had her hand up first, so go ahead.
We celebrate the day that Jesus died on the cross.
He died on Friday, but what happened on Sunday? That's what we're really celebrating. Everybody say it together. He rose, didn't he?
He rose from the
right?
Dead.
So that is exciting. All right. Let's see. I'm gonna let Case look in this bag. Case, tell me what's in this bag. You gotta look. You might not be able to feel it. You gotta look. You gotta pull it open. What's in there?
Nothing.
What do you reckon that means? What else was empty on Easter?
The tomb.
The tomb. You guys listened in Sunday school or sometime, didn't you? So the tomb was empty, and that's why we celebrate Easter today, right? It's fun to have the bunnies and the eggs and all the candy, but the tomb being empty is what we really celebrate because Jesus is alive, and he still is. All right. Can you guys say a quick prayer with me before we head out to children's church? All right. Dear Lord, thank you so much for sending Jesus to die on the cross for our sins, and thank you even more that he arose on that third day and that we can be forgiven. Please be with us as we go into children's church and the adults go into the service, and let us truly put our hearts into worshiping you. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, watch your step. I'm going to go to the nursery. Yeah. We may need help. We'll see.
And as the children are going out, if you'll stand once again, and we'll sing, Christ the Lord is risen today.
That I would wear my mask as long as anyone else was. However, yesterday, Trish and I went to support one of our young men who was playing one of his last games in college in baseball, and the back of my ears are burned. So I will put it on when I go to the back, but please forgive me for not having it on now. Just a couple of pieces of information before we go to prayer. The memorial service for Edna Yates will be this coming Thursday at 2 o'clock here in the sanctuary. The family will visit with friends in the Family Life Center from 1 to 2. Also, I don't know all the arrangements for Tammy Bishop's mother, who passed away this past week, but we will get that information to you as quickly as we can. Let's join together in prayer. God, thank you. Thank you for looking out for us when we couldn't look out for ourselves. Thank you for providing for us a way of forgiveness when we couldn't earn it. Thank you for allowing your Son, Jesus Christ, to leave his place alongside you in heaven. Come down and be one of us. and ultimately give his life on Calvary's cross. We thank you for his great sacrifice for us so that we have the opportunity to be forgiven of our sins. But Father, we thank you that today we celebrate that death could not hold him. Death did not have a victory. Death did not have a sting. And for that, we give you praise and honor and glory, because we worship today not a dead God, but a living and risen God. Thank you so much for all the many things that you have done, but in particular that. Father, we lift up to you now those of our church family and others who have needs. We do continue to remember the family of Edna Yates, that you would give them the encouragement and comfort they need during these days leading up to their mom's memorial service. And Father, I pray that you might be with Tammy and Harvey and all the family during this time of the loss of her mom. I pray, Lord, that she might feel your comfort and peace during this time. God, we also pray for those of our church family who will be having surgery. We pray for Alan Kopinski as he prepares for the laser surgery on his vocal cords on Friday. We pray, Lord, that everything would go well with that. Give him your peace as he awaits that time. And we continue to lift up Miss Chris to you, that you might provide the date soon so that she can have that surgery on her hip. But Father, we thank you for the many blessings that you have given in answer to prayer. We thank you that Teresa's able to be here with us today after her foot surgery. And I just pray, Lord, that you would continue to have your hand of healing upon her. Continue to be with Raina, Lester, and others who are recovering from surgeries. We thank you, Lord, that Miss Brenda Adcock is able to be with us today. And we pray, Lord, that you might use those who are helping to care for her during these days, that they might feel your strength and encouragement also. And God, continue to be with the others of our church family that are on our prayer list. Father, we also pray for those friends and family members who have needs as well. We pray that you would be with Harvey Bishop's son and his fiancée and unborn child. We pray that you would be with Virginia Minor's son as he continues to recover from the procedure he had done on his heart. Continue to be with Tim Davis's cousin, Kathy Duke, that you might have your hand of healing upon her if it could be your will. We also pray that you continue to be with David Askew's brother Bobby as he deals with the problems with his kidney. Help him to feel your presence and your love during these days. Continue to be with Gail Birdsong's grandson-in-law-to-be, that as he recovers from the heart attack and stroke that he experienced at such a young age. We also pray for Sandy Fuquay's sister-in-law, Bonnie Hobby, that you would have your hand upon her. And Lord, we just lift up to you the others that are a part of our family and our church family. And Lord, I just pray that you might help us to trust you, to know that you will move and work in each of these situations. We pray, Lord, continually for those of our church family who would love to be here today but are unable due to not being able to get out and about as they once did. And I pray, Lord, that they might feel your presence as we pray for them. And God, we pray for those who are in nursing homes and retirement centers. I pray that you would let them know of your love, of your care, of your concern. And God, we just lift up to you now this church, this service, that we would seek to follow your leadership and your will, that this worship service would be done to glorify and honor your name, that nothing about it is for us, our glory, but rather it's for your glory. And so I pray that we will give you the praise that you deserve and that you are worthy of. Be with us through the remainder of this hour as I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thursday evening, we had a less formal type of partaking of the Lord's Supper as we looked at a couple of hymns about the Lord's Supper and what they should mean to us. Today, as we come, we look back to that time just before Jesus went to the cross, when he gathered with his disciples in that upper room. He gathered with them to share the Passover meal that was a reminder each year for the Israelites and for all Jewish people that God delivered them from captivity in Egypt to freedom in the Promised Land. And he gave a new meaning to the Lord's Supper for us, the Passover meal. He took a couple of the elements that are a part of it, and I don't think his disciples fully comprehended what he was saying that night, but after his death, I think they understood. But he took just an ordinary part of the bread, and he broke it, and he blessed it. And he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." In just a moment, we will share together the bread. You open one end for the bread and then the other for the cup. But when he passed the disciples the bread, he said, "Take, eat in remembrance of me." Remember what he did on the cross for you and me. A part of the Passover meal actually were four different cups that represented four different parts of the Passover meal. And he took one of those cups that usually was drunk after the end of the meal together, and he gave it new meaning as well. He took the cup, he blessed it, and then he said, "This is my blood and a new covenant with you. As often as you drink, do so in remembrance of me." May we remember his blood that was shed for us as we drink. Let's join together for just a moment of prayer, please. Father, thank you that we do not have to be perfect to participate in your supper, that all we have to do is be forgiven. And for that, we give you thanks. And I pray, Lord, that as we think throughout the day, that we will remember the sacrifice that you made of how your body was broken for us, how you had your hands and your feet pierced with nails, of how your side was opened with a spear. And I pray, Lord, that we would be thankful for that. And Lord, I pray that we would remember your love letter to us, as our choir has so beautifully sung, that you wrote that you love us in red, your blood. Thank you, and may we always remember how much you have done for us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I will be reading from Luke 24, 13 through 24 in the NIV version. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. About Jesus of Nazareth, they replied, he was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him.
You didn't know that when you came to church today, you were going to have to take a quiz, did you? I'm going to show you a list of 8 dates. If you know at least what happened on at least one of those dates, raise your hand. 2, 3, 4, 5. I was going to say, if y'all got to 8, I was going to have to check you. But however, these are important dates in history. On October 31st, 1517, Martin Luther nailed his 95 Theses to the Wittenberg door, which essentially began the Protestant Revolution, or Reformation. October 14, 1492, you may very well have known that Christopher Columbus landed in the Americas. April 15, 1912, the sinking of the Titanic. December 7, 1941, Pearl Harbor was attacked. And of course, that was when we entered into World War II. July 20, 1969, Neil Armstrong set foot on the moon. June 18, 1983, and I bet you only 2 of us knew that. That's why I was going to check you. But I do know my anniversary. June 18th, 1983. January 28, 1986, the Challenger explodes. And then September 11, 2001, of course, we had the attack on America that day. These are all important dates to most of us. One of them, of course, being more important to Trish and myself than any others. But I have a feeling that we did not know the exact dates of most of these. Just to see a date did not tell us what the event was, but as soon as you saw the event, most of them I'm sure that you probably knew. But I would say there's one more day that's more important than any of these. And of course, that day is Easter. Now, we don't celebrate it on a particular day of the year, but rather in conjunction with the moons. I've always said I wish we just did it on the first Sunday of April every year so we'd know exactly when it was. But that's not the way that we do it. But it is not, does not matter exactly what day it falls on, whether it's April 17th, one year it fell on April 1st. There are all kinds of days in which it has fallen, anywhere from mid-March to near the end of April. But Easter affected the world more than any of these others. And Easter should affect us more than any of these others, because Easter reminds us of God's love. Easter reminds us that death did not have the victory. And my prayer is that as we think about Easter, we will think about those who Jesus encountered while right after he had risen from the grave. As we think about the empty tomb, there were women who got up very early in the morning, and they went for the sole purpose of anointing his body, because a proper burial anointing had not taken place due to the rush of being late, and did not want to do it on the Sabbath. And so they went early on that Sunday morning, and they discovered that the tomb was empty. I'm sure the thing that they were really wondering is, how are we going to move that big old stone out of the way? But the stone had been moved away, hadn't it? And the women went in, or at least looked in, and they saw that the tomb was empty, except for the clothes or the cloths or that Jesus had been buried in. And they didn't know what to do. And then the angels appeared to them and said to them, "Why are you looking for him among the dead? He told you before he left the world that he was coming back, that he would defeat death. But in the midst of our grief, it's sometimes hard to remember what someone has said before." But these women, when they found out, they didn't remain there. They went back and they told some other people about it, didn't they? They went and told the disciples. And if you go back and read the first 12 verses of this particular chapter, you will find where it says the disciples were basically skeptical of what those women were saying. Really, what they were thinking is, man, these women are crazy. These women don't know what they're talking about. And so a couple of them, as our scripture told us, got up and they went to the tomb. And sure enough, it was empty. But still, they had not yet encountered the Christ, the resurrected Christ. And so there are two, Clopas, and then I'm not sure who the other is because he's unnamed. But they're walking to the city of Emmaus. And while they are walking, a person joins them. And they begin to talk with him, and he says, "Well, what are y'all talking about?" He said, "Are you the only person around here that doesn't know the story? Don't know what happened? That the tomb was empty this morning when they went to check for Jesus?" But still, they did not recognize him. And when they got to Emmaus, he was going to continue on. But they said to him, "It's almost night. Why don't you stop and stay with us?" And so he did. And they began to share a meal together. And at that point, they recognized who he was. When he broke bread with them, and suddenly they knew. Now, was this just a chance encounter that Jesus ran into these two men along the road to Emmaus? I don't think it was. I think Jesus knew exactly the plan that he wanted to carry out. And that became one of the most important encounters that these two men would ever have. And they went and told the disciples. That's the second time they've been told, isn't it? And yet they're still not real sure. They just know the body's not in the grave, but they don't know for sure. But the women had told him he's alive because the angel had told them. And then these men knew he was alive because they had actually met him face to face. And so finally, if we go through the remainder of the chapter, we will find that Jesus came to his disciples. He met with them. And I believe that he was helping them to deal with their doubts. Helping them to deal with the fact they thought those ladies were crazy. Because indeed, Jesus was alive. And he relieved their doubts. You remember in one of the other Gospels, in the Gospel of John, Jesus appeared to 11 of the disciples, but Thomas was not with them. And you remember Thomas's response? "Unless I see the holes in his hands and his side. I will not believe. And so Jesus helped to alleviate that doubt by letting Thomas see his hands, see his feet, see his side that had been wounded by what had happened. Sometimes in life, we too have doubts, don't we? We also have to think about our encounters with God, our encounters with Jesus Christ. Are they just chance? Are they just something that happens? If you ever said, well, I ran into so-and-so today. But do you ever just run into Jesus? Or do you intentionally seek him out and seek to be, to encounter him? Do we seek Jesus? Do we not only believe that he is risen from the grave, but do we seek to spend time with the one who is alive, the one who is there for us? But I think there are some hindrances to being able to truly encounter Christ. Each one of us have some hindrances that might be different from others. Those things that might keep us from really spending time with Jesus, that it might be a barrier. And the first one, I would believe, that is fear. These folks that Jesus met, whether it was the women, whether it was these two men on the road to Emmaus, whether it was his disciples, most of them responded with fear when they realized who he was, when they realized they were having a face-to-face encounter with him. So how do we deal with the fear that we might face in our lives when we seek to encounter Jesus Christ? I think we can overcome that fear by truly coming into his presence regularly. That we can't have a good relationship with him unless we spend time with him on a regular basis. That's true in relationships that we have with one another. And it's certainly true in our relationship with God. And so I would encourage each and every one of us to make sure that we seek to be in the presence of Christ more and more. Because when we do, he will grant to us his peace. In that chapter, when he was among the disciples, he said, "My peace with you." In John 14, we always usually read the first six verses, but we don't get all the way to verse 27. But Jesus said, "My peace I give to you, not as the world gives peace, my peace I give." And his peace certainly is different when we will trust him. And when we trust in his peace, it will help us to deal with whatever fears that we might be experiencing. Another hindrance can be that of grief. I think that was what was going on with the ladies when they went to the tomb. They didn't know what else to do, so they decided that they would go and anoint his body. They had to be doing something because they were hurting. They had lost this person that had been so important to them. The disciples had lost the man whom they had spent so much time with and learned so much from. But how do we get over our grief? I believe that we can overcome our grief by hearing God speak to us. But too often we're in such a rush, such a hurry, that we're so busy that we don't have time to really hear. But oftentimes we have to just stop and truly listen to his still small voice that will be speaking loudly to our hearts and to our spirits. But we have to trust him that he will take care of us even in the midst of our loss. But a third hindrance or barrier is that of doubt. I'm just not sure whether I can really trust God to do that or not. You say that you've never said that? Maybe not. But my question is, have you ever given something to God and then you picked it back up and tried to handle it yourself? I'm guilty many times. But we have a tendency to doubt whether God can really do what he said he will do for us. So how do we overcome those doubts that we might face? By being in the presence of God, experiencing his presence and experiencing the work that he has done in our lives and will continue to do in our lives. Through trust, through faith. But too often, we're too busy to really see God at work. We're too busy to trust him to not try to handle it ourselves. And the only way that we can have a true encounter that will make a difference in our lives is by allowing God to help us overcome our doubt. And then I've already alluded to this one, but it's perhaps the one that we have the hardest problem with here in America today. Busyness. We're always too busy, have too much going on, don't we? So then how do we counter that busyness so that we can encounter Jesus Christ? Be still and know that God is God. Let him be God in your life. Sometimes we don't have to do anything to encounter Christ, but to be still. To give him the chance to speak and move in our hearts and lives. And so my prayer is that we'll do that. And when we do that, I think that it will help us to let go of our past and to live in the present and into the future. Christ helps us when we know that he has risen. We don't have to worry about sin when we've trusted our life to him, do we? When we've confessed our sin to him. When we remember what happened on Easter Sunday morning, we don't have to worry about death. As Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15 that I used this morning in the sunrise service, where, O death, is thy victory? Where, O death, is thy sting? And then he goes on to say that the victory was won through Jesus Christ, our Lord, when he defeated death. And so if we will let go of our past, we can do that when we have encountered Christ. But a second thing that we need to do like everyone who encountered Jesus is we need to go and tell other people what we have seen and heard. Yet we have a tendency to not say anything to people around us. Well, I don't want to offend them. They don't mind offending you. But what's offensive about sharing what Jesus Christ did on the cross of Calvary for your sins and for their sins? What's offensive about that? If they take offense to that, then it's their problem, not yours. Go and tell others what you have seen and heard. And then finally, when you have encountered Christ, go out and live for Jesus every day with excitement and joy. Hadn't done it in a long time. Smile if you think God's done something good for you, because I can see your frowns today. God has touched our lives, and we ought to be excited. We ought to be joyful. We ought to be the people that wonder what's going on in their lives. I want what they have. And when we have truly encountered Christ, we will be living in such a way that that's exactly what others will want. And when we do that, we can have confidence. Confidence in who we are and what Christ has done. We can have purpose in our lives. We know what he wants us to do and we can go and do it. We can have clarity as to the direction that he is leading, guiding, and directing us. And we can have abundant and eternal life. when we truly encounter Jesus Christ, the Savior and Lord. Easter reminds us of what he has done for us. Yet oftentimes we forget. In closing, I'm going to give you one more date. On February 27th, 1990, when Desert Storm was going perhaps at its strongest, a woman by the name of Ruth Dillow received the worst news possible. She received the news that her son, a private in the army, had stepped on a landmine and he had been killed. I cannot imagine how much grief she must have experienced to lose her child. She said there were no words that she could say. And she said for 3 days, all she did was grieve and mourn over the loss of her son. But then on the third day, her phone rang and she almost didn't answer it. But she picked it up and he said, "Hey, Mom, it's me. I'm alive." Now, she thought it was a joke. No way had the army gotten it wrong. But as he continued to talk, she recognized his voice. And her son was indeed alive. There is hope for all of us because Jesus is alive. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for this day to celebrate all that you have done for us. And I pray, Lord, that as we consider the encounters that we would have with you in the days ahead, I pray, Lord, that we would get rid of those things that might hinder us from being able to spend time with you, and that you would show us the ways in which we can do that. And I pray, Lord, that as we encounter you, our lives will be touched and changed, and we will no longer be the same. Thank you for all that you do, that we get to see that you met with many of your disciples and others. And I pray, Lord, that we might know that you come to us and speak to us through your word and through your spirit. For I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our hymn of closing is, "I Lay My Sins on Jesus." If God is speaking, won't you come as we stand together and sing. Christ the Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Christ the Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
And Father, we thank you for that gift to us. And we know because he is risen that we too, through our relationship with you through him, will also rise again. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.